So we our domain is the Northeast Shelf ecosystem, which we are all just so lucky to be able to be a part of. I know as a recreation angler myself, I benefit from the bounty of the Southern New England, as many of you and in other parts of the region. And so understanding the interactions between offshore wind energy development, which we are pursuing to achieve our decarbonization goals to address our climate crisis, in the interactions on the resources, and particularly on fishing communities, including recreational fisheries, is really key. And NOAA Fisheries and the Northeast Fisheries Science Center, our regional office, work in basically four major areas of effort. And this effort to understand recreational fisheries interactions really supports the efforts that we're engaged in at the regional level, you know, to support the regulatory and scientific review process, where BOEM is the lead agency to develop, sustainably develop and plan for offshore wind energy development. Fisheries considerations, particularly recreational fisheries, are critical in understanding use and patterns, and recreational fisheries data is really important to inform those processes. And the other area that's really critical for us, where recreational fisheries and using potentially recreational fishing modes in surveys is mitigating the impacts in our surveys. As offshore wind energy develops, it will interact with our current observation systems. So new observation systems are going to be really key, and we're starting to work on that. And we have an agreement with BOEM to implement survey mitigation activities. We're actually looking at a potential application of hook and line survey methods to sample of close to turbines where other sampling methods aren't available. And so relying on that expertise and knowledge of hook and line sampling is key for us. The other area of importance where this workshop can help inform our future work is really advancing research on NOAA trust resources. That's a fairly large area effort is what are the interactions, whether they're potentially impactful, positive, negative, or not at all. Understanding those interactions is key. If areas where we develop offshore wind energy become artificial reefs, and we know that is a likely scenario because that's what we're building structure. And when we put structure in the ocean, we attract organisms and animals and have those types of effects. If we are potentially increasing productivity in the area, but we're not monitoring that activity, those fish don't exist in our assessments. So being able to develop and design effective monitoring programs to understand those interactions is really vital to us. And then also advancing the science on mitigation, where we're looking to avoid, minimize, and mitigate any potential impacts on our recreational fisheries. So those are four major areas that we're focused on, and efforts such as this really will help feed into our efforts to achieve, you know, our goal of sustainable offshore wind development while also promoting ocean co-use and maintaining the health of marine ecosystems. So thanks for the chance to speak a few words, Jen, and I'll pass this off.
Great. Thank you, Andy. Appreciate that. And we're going to quit sharing your screen. I know that. And but just to begin, so again, my name is Jen McCann, and I'm with the University of Rhode Island Coastal Resources Center and Rhode Island Sea Grant. And you're going to stop sharing your screen, right, Andy? And as Todd mentioned, so now I get to see myself, right, in the spotlight here. So as many of you know, we said that, you know, we are going to be highlighting existing research activities and tools related to, again, better understanding, you know, the impacts and changing behavior of recreational fisheries due to the accelerated growth of offshore wind energy. We're also wanted to identify significant gaps and solutions. And so we're hoping that the focus of the conversation will be that. And just needed to mention and wanted to mention that this effort is being funded by the Cooperative Institute for the North Atlantic region, CINAR, and Sea Grant. And while we understand this topic is valuable nationwide, we have many of you are coming from other parts of the country. For tonight, our geographic focus is from Maine to New York. We're talking a lot about what this night is and what this event is. I want to be very clear, while a very important discussion to have, this meeting is not about discussing if offshore wind energy should take place or to make it, or to create a list of all the uncertainties related to offshore wind energy. That's not the purpose of this meeting. We only have, believe it or not, 2.5 hours. I know that's a long time, but it's going to fly because we have a lot of things to share and we want time for discussion about the topic that we said this meeting was about. And moderators have been instructed to keep the conversation focused. And given the time limitation and out of respect for everyone in the room, if someone does not, honor the norms, which we're going to share in a minute, or continually tries to take this meeting in a different direction than the set goals, we will encourage you to email me. Please email me, and I'm happy to have a further discussion with you about some of these topics. So just wanted to point that out. We do have a focus of this meeting, and we've chosen this webinar forum, as much as possible to encourage discussion and access. And we are asking you to help us maintain this opportunity to have these interactions. You are welcome to write your comments in the chat, and we will capture all the questions that you have in the summary notes that we'll be doing. And again, moderators are going to do their best in capturing your questions and integrating them into the discussion. But the fact is they may not be able to capture everything. So, we will capture them in the summary notes. And again, if you have questions, if you would like me, sorry, my light's going off, please email me and we're happy to discuss that. We're sharing right now two Google Docs, okay? And this is an opportunity for us to talk and engage together. So Abby's gonna put that in the two Google Docs. One is called resources. And if you go onto the resources document, the purpose of the resources document is to capture any type of report or workshop or publication, newspaper article that really is relevant to this topic. We really wanna, understand this topic and not reinvent the world, build upon what is already happening. So we welcome you to add your information here. We will have this document will be available for at least 2 more weeks after this session. The second document is a little bit more complicated. It's called targeted questions. And the purpose of the targeted questions is to really hear from you, based on what you're hearing tonight, but also based on what what information is lacking, that's needed for understanding recreational fishing behavior change due to the accelerated growth of offshore wind energy. And also, what needs to be done to fill these gaps? And also, is your point, focused on enhancing our understanding of baseline information and or monitoring? So hopefully, if you click on that and keep that open while we're discussing and fill in some of the comments. I know Chris Kincaid just emailed me something that he thought was of interest and would be of value to this conversation. Chris, put that in the resource list. That would be great. And if you have gaps or suggestions, that these documents are a good place to capture that. So with that, we really thank you for joining us, you know, tonight. And I'm going to pass it over to Doug Crystal, who's going to be moderating the first session. So, Doug, it's all yours.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for attending, and I appreciate the opportunity to introduce the fine set of speakers we have, as well as rapporteurs who are going to lend their expertise. We're going to focus on leveraging some of the information that we need to fill those gaps that Jen, Andy, and Todd mentioned, and that particular gap of today's focus is recreational anglers. As many of you know, we have a lot of information describing where and when and how commercial fishing activities happen, but we have less information relative to recreational anglers. So Scott's going to start us off with a presentation on some of the work that he's conducted that explores alternative means to collect information on recreational angling activity. And then we can supplement it with Q&As and discussion points with our experts, Emma Chalkin, an economist with BOEM, as well as Tony DeLerni, a captain and advisor on fisheries and recreational issues from New York. So with that, I'll leave it to Scott, an economist with the Northeast Fisheries Science Center from NOAA, and he's going to present to us on his recent work regarding fish rules and fish brain app and how we can apply that to the offshore wind context. So Scott, take it away, please.
So almost all I know about wind energy, I learned from Doug. So thank you, Doug. Again, my name is Scott Steinbeck. I'm an economist. I work at the Northeast Fisheries Science Center, and I've been studying recreational issues in the Northeast for a long time now. And today, I'm going to tell you about some work that we've been doing to begin to understand potential impacts from offshore wind development on private boat recreational fishing. In particular, private boat fishing for council-managed species. So species that are managed either by the New England Fishery Management Council or the Mid-Atlantic Fishery Management Council. And we have a couple that are managed by the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission as well, because they're important species to anglers in the Northeast. We do not cover highly migratory species in this work, but I believe we'll talk about that in the next session. We do have a paper. This work is based on a paper that we published 4 months ago, and it's listed in that resources doc that Jen or someone just put into the chat. And also it's in a link to that in the email that was sent out about the workshop as well. I'm only going to scratch the surface of that paper here today. In terms of trying to estimate private boat recreational activity occurring at offshore wind energy areas. Let's see here. The primary challenge is understanding where private anglers fish. So we have a lack of spatial data on private angler trips. The MRIP survey, or it's the NOAA survey, the Marine Recreational Information Program survey, it only collects generic fishing locations. So, you know, were you fishing inland in state waters, 0 to 3 miles, or in federal waters? We don't have higher resolution spatial data than that for recreational fishermen at a wide scale. So that's a problem. And there's a high cost and complexity associated with developing new data streams. So if you wanted to run a survey, somehow design a survey to collect information from anglers that are fishing at these wind turbines, it's going to be costly. It's going to be complex. So what do we do about that? How do we move forward here? Well, one possible solution is to leverage alternative data sources that are developed for other purposes. Now, there's satellite data, there's geospatial remote sensing data available now that can be purchased from third parties, because everyone carries one of these with them now, a cell phone. There's also recreational fishing apps that may collect location data as well. And that's where we turn to. I had a working relationship with one particular app called Fish Rules. It was down in Florida, and it was designed by someone I knew to use for him and his buddies just to track changes in regulations down there. I really liked the app, and I helped him expand it up. Now covers the entire East Coast, every state in the East Coast, through the Gulf, even out mostly out on the West Coast in Hawaii. And what it does is it uses the GPS and the calendar in your phone to tell you what the regulations are on the day you're fishing and the exact spot you're fishing. So to minimize confusion as to what the regulations are. NOAA and ASMFC, they often change regulations yearly. It's hard to keep up. So this was just designed to provide anglers with a way of looking up regulations for the species that they're after. As part of that, though, every time someone searches for regulations for a particular species, the coordinates of that search are logged. And so I had access to this data. So we obtained 2 years of Fish Rules app data, and we wanted to see if we could use anonymized Fish Rules georeference search data to understand, you know, where anglers are going, the spatial distribution of private recreational fishing, which of course would be important for understanding the effects of wreck fishing and offshore wind development, as well as any other type of area management might be restricted due to seasonal spawning or dynamic protected species closures, for example, marine spatial planning, even offshore aquaculture development. So we wanted to explore if we could use this data. So the first step that we did was we scanned the Fish Rules data for clusters of species regulation views. We wanted to see if we could find sort of high concentrations in an area of regulation views for a particular species. And we wanted to test whether the distribution of points, which is latitude, longitude, location data, which represent anonymous anglers accessing species-specific regulations, whether or not those points were spatially uniform. You know, were they random out in the ocean, or were the points clustered together? We wanted to use this data to get an idea where anglers are fishing, so it was important to understand if we could do this. And we use what's called a Caldor's flexible spatial scan statistic to do that. It's in the paper. I won't go into that here. This scan statistic, I thought about this for a couple of years and could not come up with an approach to do this, but my co-author, Garrett DePiper, figured this out. And it was originally developed for epidemiology studies of disease clusters. And he was able to use it for this Fish Rules data, with this Fish Rules data. So the first step was to identify if there were clusters of views. And then if we found clusters, did they have any meaningful linkage to actual fishing activity? Because remember, these are just people on the water looking up regulations for particular species that didn't necessarily mean they were actually catching those fish. So we needed to be able to understand if we could. What we did was we used the Fish Rules data and we compared that to an independent data set of catch at a spatial level. And that independent data set was the for-hire logbook data from Northeast Vessel Trip Reports. So in the Northeast, electronic vessel trip reports are required to be submitted for for-hire boats to fish federally permitted species. So similar to commercial vessels. And the EVTRs, they submit them electronically, include the coordinates that represent the majority of the fishing effort on the trip. We also have catch data on that trip as well. So we wanted to test if the clusters that we identify from the fish rule search data match up, if there's high concentrations of harvest from the logbook data in these clusters, then that would mean we could use the fish rules data. It would represent, you know, fishing for those species in those clusters. And we use what's called a first order stochastic dominance test to do that, again, in the paper. The third step is the most important step for why we're here, and that's any species clusters identified in the first step and validated with the for hire data in step two were compared across the 26 offshore wind and energy lease areas in the Northeast. We did not consider any of the floating offshore areas in the Gulf of Maine. I'll show you a graph of this in a little bit. So the results of those three steps. In terms of step one, when we tried to identify clusters in fish rules with this flexible scan statistic, we found 24 clusters across 11 different species. Some species had more than, you know, one cluster, as you will see. Step two was we needed to validate that information so that we could indicate whether or not those searches on regulations actually met areas where anglers were fishing. So the for hire VTR data showed that harvest of these 11 species within the clusters was statistically higher inside the cluster than outside. So that does suggest that fish rules views can be used to identify species-specific fishing locations. So we can use the fish rules data. It indicates fishing locations for these 11 species that I'll show you. Step three was, of the 26 wind lease areas identified in the Northeast, all but seven of them overlap those clusters to some degree. So 19 of the wind lease areas had, based on this work, show that there's recreational fishing for particular species occurring at them. So here are the wind lease area overlay results. Hopefully you can see this. If not, it's in the paper, this table. But up in the upper right-hand corner are the 26 wind lease areas where we overlaid this data. And in the table, it shows the percentage of each wind energy area that overlaps a fish rules species cluster. So I've bolded 6 of these areas, and the Revolution Wind 486 and Empire Wind 512, they overlap the most clusters at 6. So for Revolution, Atlantic cod, it overlaps the Atlantic cod clusters, the black sea bass, the haddock, the scup, the summer flounder, and the tautog. And so the Revolution and Empire overlap the most. And then Sunrise, Bay State, Park City, and Atlantic Shores, they each overlap 5 clusters. So what this suggests is that development of these particular wind energy areas, the ones in bold, are likely to impact wreck fishing for numerous species. You know, but there's heterogeneity in how much any one wind energy area overlaps a species cluster. So if you look at, say, South Fork off of Rhode Island, it falls 100% within the Atlantic cod and haddock clusters. So Atlantic cod and haddock fishing are pretty important there, according to this, in the South Fork area, wind area. But others, like look at South Coast, 521, now less than 4% of South Coast falls within the black sea bass clusters. And that's the only species with which it overlaps. So there's not a lot of recreational activity occurring there, according to this. So again, you can look through this. It's in the paper, this table. There's a lot of information here. I don't have time to go through it all. When we drill it down to the species level, this is black sea bass here. These charts are also in the paper. So a positive observation indicates black sea bass regulations were accessed in fish rules. So those are all the green dots that you see on the screen. There's a lot of observations in fish rules, particularly for black sea bass. But so those green dots identify actual spots where anglers looked up black sea bass regulations. And then a negative observation indicates regulations for where another species was viewed, the black circles. And sometimes they look like they're filled in. Those just overlap each other there. The squares that you see here illustrate, they're 10-minute squares, and they illustrate the location and significance level of four black sea bass clusters, and they're yellow. You want the lowest p-value that you can get. The lower the p-value, the higher the probability that the fish rules clusters identify hot spots of black sea bass activity. And there's four black sea bass clusters here. The 10-minute grids aggregate some of those together to make up the cluster. So the northernmost one, you know, off the coast of Rhode Island and eastern Long Island there, that's the first cluster. The second one, or the group of those yellow squares that are just west of Long Island and off of New Jersey. The third one is off of Delaware Bay. The fourth one is kind of off of Chesapeake Bay. And those four clusters overlap 17 wind leased areas. And black sea bass has the highest number of overlaps of any species that we analyzed. Unfortunately, if we could drill down, we could see, you know, exactly which wind lease areas these overlap. But we can't see that from this chart here. But that's laid out in the paper. But there's likely to be differential biological impacts of offshore wind development across species, of course. And black sea bass prefer structured bottom habitat. So it's likely that they'll be drawn to wind energy areas once they're built out and potentially even have increased catch rates. But this assessment that we're providing here just simply provides a static view of the estimated recreational activity at the wind energy areas now. So it provides a baseline. And we would need to reassess these clusters on an ongoing basis to understand the longer term impacts on private rec fishing from wind farm development. But we could do that using this approach. But what you're looking at here is just the baseline. Let's look at Atlantic cod. For Atlantic cod, there's three clusters. We have one up in the Gulf of Maine, but again, we didn't look at any of the proposed floating offshore wind energy areas, so none of them overlapped up there. The second one is, you know, just off of southeastern Cape Cod. Again, no wind energy areas there. But the southernmost one off of Rhode Island there, around Cox's Ledge, that cluster overlaps seven wind lease areas there, which are all highlighted in blue. So similar to black sea bass, you know, cod prefer structured bottom habitat as well. So they could be drawn to the wind energy areas as well. But that, just to reiterate the approach outlined here, it could be used to evaluate species level changes in angler catch after development of the wind energy areas. But all we've done so far is the baseline look that you're seeing here. This shows you summer flounder. And there are three clusters here that overlap 13 wind leased areas. And unlike black sea bass and cod, you know, summer flounder prefer sandy habitat. So at least the existing research that I've found anyway suggests little impact to this species or its fishery from wind energy development. But the scale of the planned wind development is really unprecedented. So it could lead to nonlinear impacts on sand-dependent species. So an offshore wind has at least the potential to displace anglers targeting, you know, species that prefer that sandy habitat, such as summer flounder. But again, this is just the baseline. We could use this approach to see how, you know, this type of behavior, anguish catching summer flounder, changes over time, if it does at all. This slide and one more slide. So the recreational fishing app data, in this case, we use fish rules, can be used to inform ocean use management. It is a low-cost, non-invasive approach for quantifying these species-specific spatial and temporal patterns of private angler use of marine resources. So it is, again, it could be very costly and complex to try to collect this information through some randomized survey design. So I think that, you know, using all available data is the way forward. And we've shown at least one way we can potentially do that with recreational fishing app data here. And again, this provides a baseline for identifying recreational fishing user groups could be impacted by spatial management decisions, but we can reassess these clusters on an ongoing basis to monitor changes, you know, after development of these wind energy areas. So in terms of our next steps, we want to evaluate the representativeness of the fish rules user, something we haven't done yet, which will be important to do. It's likely that they are somehow different than the population at large in terms of, say, the demographics and avidity. We don't know for sure, but in order to figure that out, we'd have to compare some sort of metrics like demographics and avidity to the population at large. And we have the data from surveys that we conduct, NOAA Fisheries does, across the nation every 4 to 5 years. We collect, you know, this type of information from anglers. So it will be possible to potentially compare to that. And if we were to find that there's differences, that's okay. We can weight that data and we can use it in a representative manner. Moving forward. So even if they are different, that's okay. We can make that data representative. Our second thing we'd like to do is examine the feasibility of developing offshore site choice behavioral models of fishing. So I'm an economist. We want to estimate the value of access to these turbines. How valuable is fishing at these wind energy areas to anglers? I think we have the data potentially that we need to be able to do that from these recreational fishing apps. So we're going to explore that. And then, can we characterize recreational fishing coastal community engagement? We want to be able to tie what's happening out onto the water back to, you know, communities on shore, figure out who exactly is being affected by the build out of these wind energy areas. And I think we possibly can do that as well with the data that we have, but we have not explored that just yet. And then extension of this research using other recreational fishing apps. Recently, Fish Rules was acquired by another app called Fish Brain. Fish Rules still exists as a standalone app. I highly recommend using it. But Fish Brain also includes all of the regulation data now. Fish Brain is a whole different animal. It's like Facebook for anglers, and it has a lot of users, approximately 11 million in the U.S. And so now the Fish Rules developers moved over to Fish Brain, so we have a connection to the Fish Brain app now as well. And we're working through a cooperative research and development agreement with Fish Brain now, so we can potentially extend what we're
Scott, are you still with us? I think we may have lost for a little bit.
I I lost them on my screen here.
We think we'd be able to improve the work that we're doing using the fish brain data. And that was it. That was all I had.
Thanks very much, Scott. I think we might have missed the last 30 seconds of you, or at least some of us. You went black, so apologize if you had any brilliant concluding remarks that we missed. But great presentation. Really appreciate the work that you've done and presenting it. We have a couple of questions already coming in to the chat, and I will start with DC. DC, if you want to come off mute, you can certainly do so, or I can paraphrase your question and speak to it there. Okay, I will just for the sake of time, DC asks, is there a threshold value of regulation lookups in fish rules that defines a meaningful cluster? And is there a seasonal window, or did you use any time of the year? So Scott, would you mind elaborating a little bit on the seasonal? And
yeah, so the fish rules data that we use is at a daily level. So we can look at any sort of seasonal distribution with that information. And there is a threshold, but I don't remember exactly what it is. I didn't actually run that. That would have been Garrett that ran it. But it is in the paper.
Okay, thanks, Scott. Susanna Music asks, are there models limited to presence absence, or can they be used for abundance as well?
That's a great question, but for this research, it's been presence absence. I don't know, to be honest with you, in terms of abundance, we'd have to explore that, but it works very well with presence and absence data, which is what we have here. Anglers are looking up the regulation for a particular species that they're not, so it works great.
And a question from Eric says, if it might undersample certain species, noting that fishermen on black sea bass are very well versed in the black sea bass, but maybe they're targeting another species. And so you might get underrepresented for certain species and overrepresented perhaps or for the lesser known species. I wonder if you have considered that in the work that you have done.
So I guess I'm not sure. So if the fish rules data were limited, you know, then that would show up in our probability of being able to estimate the presence, the clusters, the significance of the clusters. And so the p-value would be just too high if we didn't have enough data there. And that did happen for a couple species that we looked at, weak fish and one other one. We simply could not identify clusters because of the limited data there. So hopefully that answers the question.
Okay. And Seraphie asks a question about the geodata indicating anglers are mostly seeking information on land or at sea. And hopefully you can talk about that. I think you intimated a little bit so that there are both land and sea, and we could use it for different purposes.
Yeah, so folks could sit at their desk like I am right now at home and look up a regulation in fish rules. And so then we would have, and that would be geo-recorded in the data. So, and then others out at sea could obviously can look up the regulations, and you can even use your pointer and manually mark a position out on the water and ask what the regulations are there. So we had to take all that into account. For this work that we did, we only pulled lookups that happened while they were actually on the water. But that is potentially how we're going to link back to the land portion to look at this. On shore sort of effects, if possible, We have a couple other ideas as well, but that is the data that we plan on using. So we still have to explore that. We'll have to make some assumptions.
I was hoping to get Tony's input on what he thinks of this data, given that he's been charter captain for many years and he's probably fished in some of these locations, maybe even overlapping with some of these wind projects. Tony, why don't you give us your thoughts on how app data or other data of similar nature could be used to address some of the gaps that we have illustrated before?
Thanks, Doug. I have a few questions that came up during the presentation. Fish rules, you know, I've sat at all three council tables, New England, Mid-Atlantic, and South Atlantic. And I saw the South Atlantic region, the fish rules was a very popular app. But I didn't detect that it was very popular in the Northeast region. So I saw one of the next steps that was listed was evaluate the users of fish rules. And I was wondering, do we have any idea of what percentage of the recreational fishermen in the Northeast might be utilizing the fish rules app? Because it may skew the type of fishermen that are using it or the number of fishermen using it may skew the results that you get. And I was wondering, I see you listed as an evaluate the users of fish rules. I'm wondering if you wanted to comment on that, Scott.
Yeah, so in terms of actual users, it's really hard to determine from an app. You get a lot of people that download it and then like never actually use it. Right, you get others that use it a lot. Sometimes you use it a couple times and not again. So it's hard to actually get a good handle on it. But there are, the last time we looked, the vast majority are in Florida. That's where it started. And it's expanded off the coast for sure. Still, a very small number relative to the total number of anglers that are out there fishing in the Northeast for sure.
Okay, that was one of my concerns as to how the individuals who are using it in the Northeast, the numbers may skew some of your results. And so that was one of the items that was...
I'm not sure it's skewing the results. The only way it's skewing the results, again, is, as I referenced, is if the users are somehow different than the angling population as a whole, which they could be. So it's possible, but we do have the ability potentially to correct for that. We have not done that yet though.
Okay. A second item that came to mind was you said that you were looking at species that were managed by both the Mid-Atlantic or the North New England councils. Yet it's clear that we're seeing a lot more of the Southern species coming into Mid-Atlantic and Southern New England waters. And none of those species there are in your study. I understand it'll complicate the study, but I know fishermen in the Northeast are targeting South Atlantic species more and more each year as they shift into our areas. As a matter of fact, one of the questions I get when I attend boat shows and I speak to fishing groups regarding offshore wind development is they ask specifically about some of the southeast, some of the southern species coming into Mid-Atlantic waters. And have we seen any, or do we suspect that the wind turbines will will become aggregation points for those species? So there seems to be an increasing concern by Mid-Atlantic fishermen to target South Atlantic species. And that those species are not listed in your study. Give it right now, the numbers might be low, but in the next few years, I suspect those numbers will increase.
Yeah, we can explore any species. We can attempt to, do the same thing for any species that are available within the fish rules app. But, the sample sizes would be small, at least for those species in the Northeast region right now. So we would have a difficult time doing anything at the moment in the using those species. But in the future, sure.
Because what's going to happen is as those species come into Mid-Atlantic waters and Mid-Atlantic fishermen are not familiar with them, I suspect they may turn to fish rules more than some of the other species that they're more commonly used to fishing for. So that's something that you may consider as you
Great point.
Both your study. That's all I have right now, Doug. I'll mute myself and give the next person a chance.
Excellent. If you have any questions, put them in the chat, or as Rob and others have said, sign in and provide your commentary and questions elsewhere. We'll certainly see what we can do to make it recorded. I wanted to toss the question to Emma at Boehm, and I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about what data that you need and how you expect you possibly use the data that Scott presented, or what other uses private angling data and evaluations can have on the process.
Yeah, for sure. When I first heard about this project, my question was, how do I get this data now? We are fresh off of the draft wind energy area designation for the Gulf of Maine. And one of the things that we noticed, we're very limited in what data we have available. We relied heavily on charter and party data provided by NOAA, and then also some VMS data. And I recognize that has a lot of data gaps to it. So we went out for, I think it was 18 fishery specific meetings in order to ensure we got all the data that we needed in our designations. So do you think that this will be available soon for us to start adding into our spatial modeling? I know, putting you under the bus.
Well, I mean, the approach has been developed. And so really you just need updated data to rerun everything. So,
right.
I mean, it's there, and we really could potentially improve it quite a bit down the road. We need to keep that in mind as well as we're going on. But yeah, it seems to be a pretty promising avenue for identifying the spatial distributions out there on the water.
Fantastic. And then the other question that I have, if the data has potentially an anonymized identifier per user, so you could see the changes in each individual user's access to certain areas and whether or not their catch is changing or their areas of interest are changing.
So that is a real sticking point, and that is exactly what we need to be able to do some of what I was suggesting we need for our next steps for the offshore site choice models. We need to know where anglers are coming from, you know, to estimate the onshore effects. We need to know that as well. So it is possible that they can provide us with that anonymized information per user. We do not have that yet, though.
Yeah, I think it would be a great resource for both you as NOAA and us as Boehm, as Boehm designs its mitigation requirements so that it includes recreational fisheries.
I was going to ask a question looking a little bit forward, Scott and Tony and Emma, if you could put your crystal ball on. And with this approach showing where fishing has occurred in certain periods of time, how long do you think it'll be until we start possibly seeing changes responding to beyond Block Island Wind Farm, of course, but more of the offshore ones? Do you have a sense on how many years you would need to take a look at it before you see responses, or will that happen pretty quickly?
I can tell you that fishermen that I speak with ask me all the time, you know, when are they going to be built, because they want to go and fish there. I mean, as soon as you put steel in the water, they're going to, and you lift the restrictions on around it, they're going to be there trying to fish, yeah, either on vertical structure or on the hard bottom itself. It was briefly touched on. Scott briefly mentioned it, but one of the effects may be, and we still don't know, is if the artificial reef effect, if this, they do have create this artificial reef effect, will there be an increase in productivity or simply an increase in aggregation? If there's just an increase in aggregation, no increase in productivity, well, what's going to happen is the exploitation rates are going to increase. And you may have the unintended consequences of it becomes a lot easier to catch those fish. And we know that recreational measures are based around catch rates. And so what may happen is, as the artificial reef effect occurs and catch rates increase, you may see a decrease in season length, because that's the way we manage recreational fisheries right now, is season length, possession limits, and size limits. So you may see an unintended consequence of reversal in that the number of fish that can be kept by individual anglers may decrease, sizes may increase, and seasons may become shorter as it becomes easier and easier to catch the fish as once the artificial reef effect occurs. Now, if the artificial reef effect results in an increase in productivity, well, then it's a wash. And that's something that we have to look at. And I've been saying this for a while. There has to be a way that we can study the artificial reef effects, productivity versus just facilitating exploitation rate.
All right. That's a great way to finish this segment. I appreciate all of your time, Scott. Thank you for giving the presentation. And Tony and Emma, thank you for your responses. I'm going to hand it over to Julia and Dave, who are going to talk about research and monitoring examples and how we can learn from past experience. Thanks very much.
Hello, everybody. My name is Julia Livermore. I'm a biologist with the Rhode Island Department of Environmental Management's Division of Marine Fisheries. We manage the state's fisheries in state waters and then participate in the regulatory process offshore as well. That also includes, you know, assisting in some of the permitting for offshore wind development. So we're extremely interested in figuring out how recreational and commercial fishing activity may be affected by offshore development activities. I've done quite a bit of work looking at commercial fishery dependent data in the past, and I'm very interested to hear about what we can do on the recreational side, because we don't have the luxury of some of the data sets that are available for the commercial fleet. But it's really essential that we determine methods to characterize recreational activity so that we can assess change over time. Along those lines, you know, we really need studies that are going to help us to determine if those observed changes are being driven by offshore wind development or if it's another driver of change. Obviously, we've talked about shifting species distributions and other things going on right now. So we need to be able to tease those things apart. So that means that we need a data set with a long enough time series, so we have a big enough sample size so that we're going to be able to actually tease out some of those scientific questions. So in the last session, we talked about a data processing and clustering tool, as well as a fishing app that could help us to understand where recreational fishing is currently taking place and how exposed those activities are to wind development. And in this session, we're going to be talking a little bit more about some ongoing research and additional tools that we might be able to use to help fill some of these data gaps. I'm going to hand it over to Dave Monty to say a few introductory words in a moment. And I just want to, before I hand it off to Dave, just a reminder, keep throwing your questions in the chat throughout this whole panel. We're going to do the three talks, and then we'll do questions at the end and have some commentary from our rapporteurs as well. But please keep adding to the Google Doc if you have any thoughts, and then any questions you have, throw them in the chat, and we'll try to get to them. And then I'll hand it off to Dave.
Thanks, Julia. My name is Dave Monty, and I'm a charter captain. I keep my boat in Warwick, Rhode Island. I'm also a fishing writer for about 12 newspapers and blogs in Rhode Island, Massachusetts, and nationally. I also work as a recreational fisheries outreach and communications consultant, working for such clients as Ocean Conservancy, Orsted, a lot of writing for the Marine Fish Conservation Network, and others. But I also do a lot of communications work for nonprofits that I volunteer for in the industry. I'm a past board member of the Rhode Island Saltwater Anglers for 13 years and edited their magazine for about a year when our late president passed away, Steve Medeiros. I've done marketing work for the Rhode Island Party and Charter Boat Association, which I'm a member of. I'm also past vice chair of the Rhode Island Marine Fisheries Council. Also presently vice chair of the Narragansett Bay Estuary Program, and on the board of the American Saltwater Guides Association. So I just sort of reviewed that just so people get a perspective of where I'm coming from. I'd like to share a slide very quickly here if I could. Hopefully folks can see that, and we're going to see if we can get it a little bit larger here. Here we go. This title, don't take no for an answer, is not meant to be derogatory in any way. We have the power on this Zoom call with the scientists on the Zoom, with the recreational fishing leaders, with the conservation groups that are on this call. There's no one better to find solutions to this challenge of who fishes in wind farm areas, what they catch, and is there going to be a change, a negative or a positive change in that? And I say solutions because I think that there's going to be more than one solution. I think it may be a combination of them. If I had a magic wand, we would know who catches fish in a wind farm area, but we don't. But I think it's important that folks know that we have a lot of tools already in place, and we need others to explore that can help us find the answer. We certainly have existing MRIP data, which is being modified, as you know, and hopefully will be more robust and accurate as we move forward. But we need to complement and supplement that with additional data, state data, some approved app data as well. We have fish abundance studies in wind farm areas in Europe. We also have a seven-year fish abundance study at the Block Island Wind Farm that was, trawls were made every single month. And we know what fish are there before, during, and after construction. We have robust research and monitoring plans. I know that we're going to hear about the Vineyard Wind Plan shortly. There is an article in the chat about the South Fork research and monitoring plan. And as you know, that plan was actually built by the Fisheries Advisory Board of the Rhode Island FAB. And that plan includes fish traps and fish pot surveys, beam trawls. It also includes fish abundance studies. Specifically, it includes acoustic telemetry studies on a number of species. So there are articles in the chat about that and other research and monitoring plans. We have angler smartphone apps, and certainly we just heard about Fish ID and Fish Brain, which may be piggybacking on that. We have charter fishing data, and I know Scott mentioned the charter fishing data is a tool. We have recreational fishing effort observation surveys. I just got an email on UMass Amherst doing a study on tarpon and hammerhead shocks, believe it or not, in Florida. And a big part of that was observation. Scientists from shore seeing who hooks up and what they catch. We have the CRMC URI Coastal Resource Center Sea Grant Angler Survey, which is great, and we're going to hear about that. So to wrap this up, and before I pass it back to Julia so that we could get into some of our presentations, now what do we do to identify wreck fishing changes, positive or negative, in wind farm areas? I think it's up to us. We can use some of these tools that I mentioned, some that we're going to hear about, but it's going to be great to hear from you what your thought is on it. So I'm going to pass it back to you, Julia, and I'm going to stop sharing my screen. Thanks, everyone.
Awesome. Thanks, Dave. So we're going to get into the talks now. We're going to give about 15 minutes for each talk and try to stick to that time frame just so we can have our breakout sessions later on. And with that, I think the first talk tonight, it's Jeff Meebone from the New England Aquarium, and he's going to be talking about some research in documenting recreational activity using existing fishery-dependent data.
Thanks very much, Julia. Just making sure you can hear me okay.
Loud and clear.
All right. Well, thanks for having me. I got 15 minutes here. I got a lot to talk about. I'm going to roll pretty quick. Again, my name is Jeff Meebone. I'm a senior scientist at the Anderson Cabot Center for Ocean Life at the New England Aquarium in Boston. I've been doing work on this idea of recreational fishing for HMS, highly migratory species, and how that interfaces with offshore wind for the past maybe 4 years. I'm going to give you kind of like an overview presentation of my thought process and how I designed some of the work that I'm doing, and then just high level information on how the work is going to be done. I fully intend on sharing these slides. I'm going to reference a bunch of reports that I've done, and you'll be able to access those links through the shared PDF presentation at a later date. So just follow along with me in the slides and I'll let it rip. Okay, so why do we need to worry about recreational fishing for HMS, highly migratory species, your sharks, your tunas, and billfishes in terms of offshore wind? Well, Scott kind of set it up well. This is the primary recreational fisheries that's going to operate in waters of interest for offshore wind development across the U.S. states from Maine to Texas and into U.S. Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico in 2022. NOAA Fisheries issued over 23,000 private angling permits for this fishery and over 4,000 charter headboat permits for this fishery. In those seven states you see listed there, the focus of this webinar from Maine to New Jersey, more than half of the permits in each sector came from those states. So this is a huge fishery in our neck of the woods in New England, and just so happens to be the area where offshore wind is progressing most rapidly, and we already have two functioning wind farms that have been built in this area are undergoing construction. So it's really an issue that we need to start addressing more aggressively. So how do we monitor changes in this fishery? Well, when I talk about this, I just start to think about like all the different factors that could elicit change in the fishery. And then behind that, what are the drivers of those changes? And it's really a really complex process. So for example, if we think about one of the potential effects of offshore wind will be potential displacement of target species. And related to that, is that related to displacement of a predatory species or the forage species that they prey upon or rely upon when they're in a specific area? So, that could be linked to an offshore wind activity, but it also could just as well be something that's driven by climate change. In other examples, so we have changes in target species of biomass. So, a population of target species like bluefin tuna, for example, could be really prolific in some years, and the stock could be in bad shape and the animals are just not available for the fishery in another. So that changes effort. Other things like economics. So if the price of fuel is $6 a gallon and guys just can't get out to the fishing grounds, that's going to affect effort. So really, when we try to ask this question or answer this question of how offshore wind is going to affect changes in effort in the HMS recreational fishery, it's really a complex issue. You're looking at intersection between forcing on animal ecology and biology. There's some human socioeconomic considerations, just human behavior. There's a ton of things that we need to pay attention to in order to really monitor and track the change. And that's going to lead to a lot of different research that we'll hopefully brainstorm a bit tonight. But regardless of the line of questioning, I'd argue that there's two basic needs for any line of questioning. And those are starting with the information on the historical and current fishing activity. So we've heard this term baseline tossed around. So whenever you want to look at a change or monitor and change, you need a before and after. So this is that before period. We really need to know what the fishery is like before any offshore wind activity takes place. And then number two, what we're also talking about here is we need to establish a framework to investigate that change consistently over time and then start to ask questions about why the changes may have occurred. And it's this number one area that I'm going to talk about for the rest of my time, and that's specific to how do we look at historical and current fishing activity in the HMS recreational fishery. So fortunately for this fishery, HMS are usually reviewed as being kind of a data poor group. But in this case, we're kind of actually data rich. There's a federal survey called the Large Pelagics Survey that has different forms But one of the forms is an intercept survey called the LPIS, Large Pelagic Intercept Survey. And that's a dockside survey that has been in effect for a couple decades that tries to collect specific information from fishermen about the fishery. So what are your target species? What things are you catching? When are you fishing? And then most importantly, the location of the fishing trip. So I think Scott mentioned this in his talk, a lot of recreational data on other species has no spatial reference, but the LPS provides that extra level of insight. So the records of catch or the trips that are taken do have a spatial reference or a location tied to them. And that's huge when you're talking about evaluating potential effects of things that are stationary in the ocean, like wind farms. So just a couple other caveats, though, about the Large Pelagic Survey. It was designed well before wind was on our radar. It is not by any means designed as a tool solely to look at changes in effort due to offshore wind. It's kind of another one of those data streams or tools that we can gather information from, but by no means is it a standalone resource for doing so. And it works great for our region. We have about two decades of data, but the survey only runs from Virginia to Maine. So as wind expands beyond this region, and it certainly most likely will, the LPS data are not there. So we continually need to look for other forms of information to supplement our knowledge about what the recreational fishery for HMS looks like. So what other types of data can tell us something about the recreational fishing effort in the region? So there's two main data streams that I've kind of tapped into when asking this question. The first I call cooperative conventional tagging data. So you see these icons here, they are just a few of the large cooperative tagging programs that exist in the United States that specifically cater to like the US Atlantic, Gulf of Mexico, and the Caribbean. And basically what all these programs have in common is they enlist the help of private recreational anglers to deploy tags on fish when they're caught. So if you think about it, anytime a tagger tags a fish, or for that matter is out and recaptures a fish and collects data on the event, that's a record of recreational fishing effort. So it's an indirect proxy for the timing and the location and perhaps even the magnitude of effort that's being exerted in this fishery. The second stream, there's been a lot of talk in a lot of the webinars that I've attended about traditional fishermen's traditional ecological knowledge. And that's something that definitely should be and could be harnessed to try to answer this question through things like surveys. So I mentioned the Large Pelagic Survey is a good tool, but it's maybe not specific to wind. But if you did develop a survey that is specific to wind, could you use it supplementary to the LPIS and really build up a more robust understanding of what's happening in the fishery, changes in the fishery, potentially even why changes are happening, just by asking anglers some simple questions? So basically what I've been trying to do is marry all these ideas. So my goals were simple to start, to just basically document the spatial distribution of recreational efforts. So that's private anglers and for hire fishing captains when they're targeting HMS in Southern New England, and just ask basic questions. What are the target species? What are the fishing tactics? Where are they fishing? And I tried to do that by marrying those couple different data streams, the Large Pelagic Survey, the cooperative tagging data, and then a little bit of social science with direct surveys fishermen. So this process has evolved over time. I'm gonna kind of try to walk you through some of the work here. So here's some results from work that I've done using the Large Pelagic Intercept Survey. And just to orient you to these graphs, basically what I did is this grid that you see on the screen here, this actually represents BOEM outer continental shelf lease blocks. So when BOEM wants to figure out what part of the ocean they're gonna lease for energy development, it's all nicely compartmentalized into these chunks, these grids. And basically what I did is I took the Large Pelagic Survey data about trips that had occurred and catch that had occurred from 2002 to 2021, and I just interpolated onto this grid. So that's just a fancy way of saying that I summed up all the trips and catches that were occurring within each one of those grid cells within this region. And it's quite simple. Any box or cell that you see that has a color means there was effort there. And the warmer the colors, so the more red, I guess, the more effort that was exerted in that cell. So you can see here, using just the large pelagic survey, we've got a pretty big footprint occurring across all of the lease areas in southern New England. But if we add a call upon another source, that being the conventional tagging data, which again, I said is a proxy for recreational fishing effort, the picture changes. We see a lot more boxes that are filled in here. We see a lot more vivid colors, which shows that there's actually maybe more effort occurring in this region than is captured by the large pelagic survey. And you can stratify this by time. Some of the programs, the tagging programs, go back to the 1950s, but you can also truncate the data like we've done on the bottom from 2002 to 2021 to just match that LPS time series. And if you could compare the large pelagic survey data on the top to the conventional tagging data on the bottom, you can see how these really should be used complementary and in addition to one another to really try to get the most comprehensive picture of what the fishery footprint really looks like in the region. Now, I really just scratched the surface with what I've done here. I have a link up in the top right to a report that really goes into this in detail where I break down these maps by species. So there's some for sharks, bluefin, yellowfin tuna, marlin. So I encourage you to check out that report if you want to see this information really broken down more by time and by species. Another thing that I've done is dabbled a little bit in social science and done some direct surveys of recreational fishermen following the 2019, 2020, and 2021 fishing seasons here in New England. So that's basically like the early winter is when I did the surveys. And the surveys were really simple, only a few questions to try to maximize responses. Focus on basic questions. So where did you fish? How much did you fish there? What are you targeting? What tactics or methods are you using to fish? And are you a private angler or charter boat captain? We advertised these through a lot of avenues, capitalized a lot here on my connections with the fishing industry to try to reach as many people as possible. And I think in those 3 years, we got between 200 and 300 responses from fishermen in each year. So the questions for this survey really kind of focused on this map here. I just drew some, you know, circles around some areas that I knew were really popular for the HMS recreational fishery in southern New England. And then through our questions, anglers were able to tell us, you know, how much time relatively they spent fishing in each area. So this plot on the right is from the latest survey in 2021, and it just shows like how many of the 183 respondents testified to fishing in each one of these named fishing areas. We also asked some simple questions about tactics. You can see here on the left, there's a lot of mobile fishing happening here. We're casting, boats are driving up onto break and fish and throwing top water. There's a lot of boats that are drifting, a lot of boats that are trolling. So a lot of moving boats going on here, which adds dynamics about, you know, fishing in a fleet or around a bunch of fish fixed structures like wind turbines. And on the right, quite simply, just a breakdown of what species anglers are targeting. And again, much more information about these results can be found in this report that I've linked here. And again, you'll see this PDF in the notes, so you'll be able to access these links. So after I worked in southern New England, this kind of took off a little bit. Matt Davis from the Maine Department of Marine Resources followed a very, very similar approach. I was lucky enough to work with Matt on this, and it turned out really well. One thing that they did differently is they used a much, much better online survey tool that actually allowed anglers to select specific areas where they fished by drawing a box on the map, and this allowed them to overlay the survey, the large pelagic survey data, and the cooperative tagging data all into one analysis. So it was really, really nice. Again, this report is linked here on the bottom. I encourage you to check it out. The other thing that they did that was different is they incorporated a little bit more of a commercial data in the form of the general category and harpoon category for bluefin tuna. And then lastly, most recently, I've entered into a collaboration with some folks at NOAA, specifically through the Southeast Fishery Science Center, to really expand this analysis more broadly. So this red region you see here on the right, that is the area over which we're going to interpolate all large pelagic intercept survey data and cooperative tagging data to try to get a deeper dive into this fishery, not only in New England, but also outside of this, the region. As you can see on the map here on the left, there is a lot of effort that's occurring in the other regions. We have almost 300,000 tag records. So we have a really, really lot of information, and hopefully this will see the light of day sometime later this year. So I know I ran out of time, a lot of stream of consciousness here. Again, I'm gonna share this so you'll be able to dig into it, but I wanna leave you with 3 points. I think there's merit in continuing to build this time series, specifically in New England. The ship has sailed. There's already things being put in the water. There's already potentially power being generated. So we need to move forward like as quickly as we can to try to start better monitoring the effect that wind may have on the fishery in New England. And then just to go along the lines that we heard before, there's definitely ways to improve both the quantity and quality of the data that we get from this fishery. And I'm really interested to hear anyone's ideas about that. So again, I know I'm over. Thanks a lot for your time. A large bunch of people to thank here, and I appreciate any questions you might have. Thanks.
Awesome, thanks, Jeff. So our next talk, we're gonna hear from Jeff Willis from the Rhode Island Coastal Resources Management Council and Scott Travers from the Rhode Island Saltwater Anglers Association. And they're gonna be talking about the Rhode Island Recreational Fishing Tool.
Thank you, Julia. And Jeff Kneebone, that was an excellent presentation. I wish I'd seen that a few years back. Thanks everybody. Jeff Willis, as Julia mentioned, from the Rhode Island Coastal Resources Management Council. A direct result of working with our Fishermen's Advisory Board, which was mentioned, I think, by Dave Monte earlier, in the South Fork project, that recreational fishing data from basically fishers coming on their own boats, coming from Narragansett Bay or off the shore of Block Island, wasn't well understood in the federal waters and lease area environment from a mitigation and impact perspective. It was really clear that everyone knew that there's recreational fishing that was occurring out there, but there was no data that we could point to say what the impacts could be from these lease areas and potential farms that were being proposed in there. So it was clear that we needed to get a better understanding of what the recreational fishing was occurring out there and the impacts for that. At the exact same time that that was happening, we had a couple of aquaculture projects within Narragansett Bay that were experiencing similar issues in terms of impacts to recreational fishing from these proposed aquaculture farms. And just for a quick perspective, aquaculture farms generally in Rhode Island are between 2 and 3 acres at a time, yet anytime there's opposition to them, in large part, the opposition is based on the recreational value of that area. And within that, what type of recreational fishing is occurring and how it will be impacted. But it's all anecdotal. And we didn't have a very good idea of what exactly was happening with recreational fishing impacts from these aquaculture projects, and again, especially with the offshore in the lease areas. So, and I will pass it off to Scott and others, but we partnered with the university and the Saltwater Anglers Association, who are the recreational fishers of the state, who understand what type of fishing's going on and where it is with their memberships, but how can we get beyond the anecdotal part of that understanding and make it more, quote, empirical, that we can use in making regulatory decisions or in the offshore environment, mitigation and compensation decisions or recommendations. So I'll leave it there, but that's the genesis of this project and how it got started.
Thank you, Jeff. I'm going to take over from this point, and then I'll hand it over to Scott. So this project was a real team effort. We wanted to examine what kind of data and research already existed in this area so we weren't reinventing the wheel. So this is just some of the research and data that we took into account over the course of several months, reviewing what's out there, what can we work with to create this kind of recreational fishing tool so we can understand where recreational fishing is happening within Rhode Island salt waters. So here, we can also make these slides available. All these links are clickable. So when these slides are shared, you can review all this data. In addition to examining the kind of data and research that's out there, we wanted to hear from the fishing community themselves and actually talk to fishers and get the latest and greatest information and data from them. So just last year, we launched our fishing survey at the New England Fishing Show. And over the course of several months after that, we had some site visits, we visited some fishing tournaments and the Rhode Island Saltwater Anglers Association monthly meetings, and administered over 300 surveys and gathered information of over 2,500 fishing locations that are important to the fishing community. So this is a screenshot of the tool that I'll be talking about that we came up with as our final product, but this is our final results. So this is an aggregate kind of gathering of all the information we got from our survey. What I want to make clear is nothing like this had ever been attempted before in Rhode Island. It's a really unique project that the team's really proud of. We worked with the fishing community and the Rhode Island Saltwater Anglers Association and all these different partners that was on that screen and what Jeff mentioned before. And we were together able to reduce these fishing site areas down to a size that's useful for management decisions and visualization. All those different cells that you see, those dots, are about 1 square kilometer. We also collected the data that synced automatically to an online database, minimizing errors. And we gathered data that included spatial information, but also the temporal component. And having information on where fishers are going seasonally is really important so we can continue to reduce conflict. Because a site might be really popular in the summer, might still mean that somebody else could utilize that same site in the winter and thereby reduce conflict moving forward. We also really tried to prioritize diversity and inclusion in the survey administration. The team prioritized attending fishing events as well as visiting communities on the ground. So the survey was very accessible. We had multilingual survey facilitators who were also available to work with different fishers who spoke multiple languages. These are some of the key findings from the survey. We have some major hotspots in Rhode Island for recreational fishing, including Fort Adams, Fort Point Judith, the Charlestown Breachway. None of this should be a surprise for super avid fishers on the call, but it was really great ground truthing data that we were able to see come to light through the survey. We also found that the top three species that are targeted when people are out fishing are striped bass, black sea bass, and bluefish. We got information again on when people are fishing throughout the year seasonally, and also who relies on the fish that they catch to supplement their diet, and do they share that with others outside their household? The answer is yes, 72% regularly do. If you're really quick, you can scan this QR code. I can also put the link in the chat after I'm done. I can't do that while sharing my screen. But we created a story map that goes over the details of this project overall and highlights some high-level takeaways from the data. We got some feedback from different team members who aren't super map-oriented that they appreciate things in story form. So we thought to make this really available and understandable to lots of different audiences, we have this story map that walks people through the tool. Speaking of the tool, this is the spatial survey extent that we used when administering the survey. So as you can see, these cells, which I mentioned were 1 square kilometer in size, are what fishers could pick from. So as people took the survey, they could select up to 5 of these cells per season that they said were a priority site to them. So they were important to them. So they could pick up to a total of 20 different sites when they were taking the survey. And this is as far out as the grid went. Some people did select other sites outside of the survey grid, but this is what we were capturing so we could better learn how recreational fishers were utilizing Rhode Island state salt waters to better inform management decisions moving forward. This is an example of the results all grouped together, and it's kind of highlighting the popular fishing areas through the different colors. So kind of similar to Jeff Niebohm's color coding, the more red you get, the higher the usage of that site. And then we wanted to include this just because it highlights even just our survey with over 300 respondents. We still got people from all over the region. I think this really demonstrates the importance of the recreational fishing industry to the state's blue economy, but also the region's blue economy, and the impact that the state's Narragansett Bay waterways have on this community. And then I'll let Scott take it from here.
Thank you, Abby. So again, I see this tool as being very important and being able to help reduce conflicts between multiple users of the same area. We've already had our first use of this, where we had an applicant approach the Saltwater Anglers Association during the pre-application phase, seeking guidance on potential aquaculture sites. This allowed for a positive discussion, provided insight into which areas may result in greater or lesser conflict for him with that application process and with that aquaculture site. And it's going to end up resulting in a very more, or in a much more efficient permitting process once he goes forward. Also, this is a fantastic tool to recruit new anglers coming into the saltwater fishing and point out areas where they could potentially be more successful in their endeavors, because they'll know where people generally fish more and they'll be better able to plan their trips accordingly. But as trends change, we can see the clear need to repeat this effort again and to focus more on areas further offshore that this particular survey did not include.
Wonderful. Thank you all. So our final speaker is Travis Lowry. He's from Vineyard Wind, and he's going to discuss their planned and ongoing research on the recreational side.
Thank you, Julia. As mentioned, my name is Travis Lowry. I'm fishery liaison for Vineyard Wind and Vineyard Offshore. And I'm just going to give an overview of what scientific surveys are being conducted within the Vineyard Wind lease area, which is a 501 currently, and the design and the practice from that. So to start, we have a fisheries monitoring plan. And with that, we really reached out. So we held workshops at the University of Massachusetts Dartmouth School for Marine Science and Technology. There was 4 meetings. Over 70 fishermen participated. And we really just wanted to get an idea of what species we wanted to focus on or needed to focus on, and what kind of survey equipment should be used and what type of survey should be done to kind of look over the monitoring of the Vineyard Wind 1 lease area. From there, we got 2019 recommendations report was completed. Vineyard Wind adopted all the recommendations that were received from there. And we began the surveys for the pre-construction in 2019. So the surveys discussed are a BACI design, so a before after control impact. And it's really looking at what's the status of the fisheries before this wind farm becomes evolved, during construction, and then post construction. And you can really see the difference between the three areas there. We also have used a lot of local fishing vessels. All of them were used for the projects mentioned. So there's a drop camera survey, a ventless trap and larval survey, and a trawl survey. And with that, we did get additional feedback that the pelagic recreational fleet was missed out on that. We couldn't pick up those species within these 3 surveys. So as Jeff discussed with his desktop study, we partnered with the Anderson Cabot Center for Ocean Life and got a desktop analysis completed and are part of a acoustic monitoring of HMS highly migratory species. And that's a regional study that has a bunch of developers within that. And then after the first year of all the surveys, we had another peer review to complete, and 3 fishery scientists reviewed the methods and results of all the reports. And then we had 8 fishermen, 2 for each of the surveys to kind of within those fisheries as well to really go over the science and give us any feedback on that. All of our reports, scientific reports, are on our website. So they are the monitoring review report and then all the annual reports for the surveys that I'll mention and touch upon. And with that, so I'm really just going to give you an overview of these four surveys that we're conducting right now for the BACI design. All right. So the first is the drop camera survey. The objective of this is to map the distribution and estimate the density of dominant benthic megafauna and classify the different substrate types. This has been a historical survey that's been completed at SMS under Kevin Stokesbury. It's mostly used for a allocation of scallop quota, so to get abundance in biomass throughout the Northeast Coast. And with this design, it's a centric systematic design. As you can see, this is the Vineyard One lease area, and then there's an adjacent control area. There's 1.5 kilometers grid, and with that, they go out twice a year and drop a pyramid that has cameras and lights. And with that, it's more of a quadrat sample. So at each of these grid positions, four drops are occurred, and it's off of a commercial fishing vessel. The fishing vessel Horizon has been used out of New Bedford. And this is gaining data on, specific information on what that substrate type is like during pre-construction. It's conducted twice, so in the summer, fall of 2019, 2020, and then the spring of 2021 and 2022. This survey is conducted, we got recommendations because there was some visibility issues at the beginning of these surveys. So we really got input to deploy these earlier in the summer and fall. So rather than May and September, we conducted them in July and October. So that is kind of the basis of this drop camera survey that's ongoing. The next survey is the ventless trap and larval survey. So with this, it estimates the size and distribution of lobster and black sea bass populations and classifies those populations. Within here, there's again the control area and the lease area. 15 stations are completed within the Vineyard Wind 1 area and then 15 in the control. At each of these stations, there's a set of traps. So there's alternating three vented, three ventless traps. And then there's a black sea bass pot at the end, which is unbaited, which was recommended from the Mass Division of Marine Fisheries to further look at that species, as they are a predator of the lobsters. There's also a plankton or a larval component of this. So specifically looking at larval lobster, but other fish are caught in the net, and it's a Knutson net. And this is towed 10 minutes at each of the stations, and it all the data is collected, preserved, and brought back to the lab to analyze afterwards. The vessels that we used were the Rock and Roll out of the Martha's Vineyard and the Encourager out of New Bedford. And this is a random sampling design. So using existing lease blocks, these were further allocated. So within each lease block, there were aliquots that were distributed and then randomly selected. And this is done annually. Each time it's randomly selected. And the sampling was done in June to October in 2019 and 2020. And then the Endangered Species Act consultation delayed and prevented 2021 survey from occurring. This also occurred in the 522 lease area, our adjacent lease area. So that's kind of really just trying to get, catch rates and information on the species as well, such as, length, sex, reproductivity, success, age, diet, disease. So all of this data is incorporated in looking at the difference within this BACI design. Another survey is the trawl survey. This is a survey that, gets catch rates, population structure, and community composition. And it follows the NEMAP survey protocol. So it follows, 20-minute tows at a desired speed of 3 knots and mimics the exact dimensions of the NEMAP trawl survey as well, so it can be used throughout and compared. It's a seasonal survey, so winter, spring, summer, and fall. There was no spring in 2020 due to COVID, and then a lot with the no summer 2021 due to the ESA constellation. And the Charles survey didn't occur in the 552 area, but it's a spatially balanced survey design. There's 20 toes in the lease area and 20 toes in the control area. There's also net mensuration gear on the doors, the wings, and the head rope to understand the area swept of the trawl. This is an image of the trawl survey during construction. So you can see a monopile in the back and a complete wind turbine generator. And that is on the Heatherland, which is a boat out of Montauk. And with that, all the catches, you know, aggregated weight from each of the species was weighed, and then individual fish are collected, and really we'll be able to tell the difference between before and after. Then the acoustic monitoring highly migratory species, all the developers within the Southern New England wind energy area have, you know, decided to do this regional study as, you know, HMS species move consistently. So this regional HMS study started in 2020, and it has tagging and acoustic receivers deployed to document movement of these species. So there's 74 within this whole lease area. There's four within the vineyard in one area, and 11 with or 12 within the vineyard northeast area. And all of these are in a buoy system deployed in May and retrieved in December. And the tagging trips are targeted between June and September. And the battery life for the tags lasts about between 3 and 6 years. And with this regional analysis is ongoing, the signing of the multi-developers agreement in 2023. So that data will be coming out. And then I just wanted to, so those are the really four main surveys that are conducted within our part of our fisheries monitoring plan. And additionally, we fund the American Saltwater Guide Association. So they're one of our fishing reps, and they have a project, the Albi Project. They tag false albacore as they migrate along the East Coast. And they are, you know, a very big recreational fish species, but don't have a lot of data on them. So really understanding where these species go. There's a bunch of sensors within the Nantucket Sound, and really understanding where these fish species are going will help within managing the species. And then we also fund the whelk research fleet from the Commercial Fisheries Research Foundation. So this is focused on channeled and non-whelk. And they use a method of collecting data via tablet, and fishermen collect catch effort and biological data to provide fisheries dependent data for inclusion in the management process. Again, this is a data poor species. So the more science, you know, the better understanding and better management can be done. And we are starting to plan fishery surveys. So Vineyard Wind is half Vineyard or half Copenhagen Infrastructure Partner and half Avangrid. Copenhagen Infrastructure Partners, also Vineyard Offshore, owns lease areas 522, which is east of Vineyard Wind 1. And there's 544, which is Vineyard Mid-Atlantic. And both of these are, you know, coming up in the pipeline. 544 has received a power purchase agreement, and 522, we are looking into monitoring and getting those fisheries monitoring plans established. So that's kind of the basis of where we're at. And then, yeah, this is just my contact information and my boss, a fisheries manager, Krista Bank. So with that, I'll close out.
Great. Thanks, Travis. Yeah. So I think at this point, we'll go to Walt and Tiffany, the rapporteurs, for just a few minutes to see if they have any, you know, thoughts after listening to the three talks, or if they have any questions for the panelists.
I think the one thing I would maybe ask Jeff probably the most is what are his thoughts on guidance for the scientific monitoring moving forward for, and we'll use HMS as an example. I mean, in terms of like standardizing or your work acting as the guideposts, if you will, for future things, like, for example, the Gulf of Maine, which has a huge area. Would you say, do you have like documentation or anything that's put together that would be like recommendations for researchers who are potentially becoming involved in this field, either in this year or years upcoming? Not that you haven't done enough already, but.
Yeah, just stay ahead of the curve. This is a fast moving field. I mean, I think it was Jeff that said, I wish I had seen your presentation years ago. I mean, I started this work years ago and I've had these data kicking around for years. Maybe didn't do the best job of letting them see the light of day, but that was probably because I was tied up doing other things. So just communication and collaboration. This is growing so fast, at least with a fishery like the HMS fishery. It's connected. It's every region. These fish basically see no bounds, as you well know. And really trying to be consistent across the region is the most important thing to me. And that's one of the things we're trying to establish with this contract with the Southeast Fishery Science Center, to really establish one system for looking at the historical footprint of the fishery across the entire range and establishing some mechanism to do it in a consistent manner, because, you know, my time working with offshore wind, it's a very fragmented field. There's a lot of people getting involved. Sometimes there's communication, sometimes there's not. And there's always talk about consistency. And I think that's one place that we're still struggling to find what we want, a need. So I would just say, yeah, communication, collaboration, consistency.
Jeff, if you don't mind, Julia, just a follow-up to that, Jeff, just so it's clear to me, the we've got great baseline data, certainly in New England. Do we have funding, and are you on board to carry this into the future to see if there are changes?
No. So I've cobbled together funding to do this work from three or four different sources over the year, just piecemeal. I started it by going to meetings on my own time in New Bedford and talking to fishery liaisons and people from BOEM, just asking questions, because I myself am a permit holder and an avid recreational fisherman. So I had kind of dual interests, and I just kind of cultivated it organically, taking little bits of money as I could and trying to extend my ideas as far as those dollars would take me. I would love to do this bigger and better and consistently, and I'm definitely searching for the support to do so. I think that my ideas can be expanded upon. I think Matt Davis's example in the Gulf of Maine, he took a framework that I started and made it better. And I think the more people we get involved, the better things are going to get.
Thank you, Jeff.
I'll jump in. Hi, everybody. Tiffany Smythe from the Coast Guard Academy and URI Marine Affairs. I'm going to focus on the first two presentations, Jeff and then Jeff and team from URI. And so I think it's really interesting because on the one hand, Jeff Nebo and your work is doing a really good job of focusing very offshore and primarily using readily available data, not a socially driven project, right? Whereas the Rhode Island project, you know, very kind of stakeholder intensive in terms of data collection and very inshore focused. And, you know, I can see values of both approaches as we fill these gaps, but I wanted to maybe hear from you both about, you know, how do we build on those, right? Like Jeff Niebohm, what do you see as the gap, maybe from even a social perspective or thinking offshore versus inshore, that we might need to address, if any? And from the Rhode Island folks, you know, how would we, what are the gaps there as we look offshore, as we think about how to scale up something that was so stakeholder intensive? I tried to capture a lot in one question. We'll see how that goes.
I guess I should go first. There was a lot there. I'm trying to remember exactly what you were asking, but I think the one thing that I would say is there's a huge value in the social side, especially when we're starting to ask the why. So I gathered a lot of data that characterizes the fishery fairly well, but if it changes, we need to know why, and that's the hard part to answer. So getting fishermen's input is huge. It's going to be pivotal to this. Now, I will say in my experience doing that work, there's an issue. I don't know if it's what the root of it is, but accuracy, I'd say. So sometimes the responses that you get may be inaccurate in terms of the amount of effort that people testify to exerting. Now, that may just be that it's really hard to recall how many times you fished in a specific area in a year, or it may be that, you know, some people might want to show that they're using the area more than they actually are. So I think I'm on my last slides. It was, I'm trying to build trust. Like, there's a lot of distrust in this industry. There's a lot of confusion because there's not a lot of information, I think. That's part of the problem. So one of the things that I try to do as a fisherman or someone who tries to pride myself in bridging the gap between science and industry is to just talk to people and really be genuine about the objectives and really convey the importance of having accurate data. I mean, we see it with bluefin tuna. You know, the reporting from the recreational sector drives this part of the stock assessment, which in turn drives regulation. So we really need that accurate information. And offshore wind is a great example of a place where there's a really good place for fishermen to slot in, but it needs to be done correctly to make it really be impactful. Thank you.
I'll just, Tiff, answer your question on the inshore part of it, because it's exactly the same answer. In that when you're gathering this type of data in a social setting, you need it to be believable to the decision makers. You need it to be believable to the regulated public, to the public that wants to use these areas outside of the applicant. So what we found with the developers, and I know there's some on now with the offshore farms, is that the information was just not credible because it was anecdotal. So in order to make decisions or get information that you can report and everybody doesn't question, the accuracy has to be there as well. And the believability has to be there as well.
I actually have a question kind of building on that, just in talking about, you know, being able to trust the data. There's also an issue with transparency sometimes with these data sets, whether it's the biological data sets that are being collected by the developers. I think Todd asked, you know, how does one get access to that data if you want to work with it? Is it available? What's the process like? But then also on the fishery dependent side, you know, that's often proprietary data. So there are strict confidentiality rules around using it. So do you guys have any thoughts on ways to work around this issue while, you know, maintaining people's privacy, but also getting at addressing the scientific questions at hand here?
Yeah, I can jump in there. I actually jump through these hoops a lot with my work, and boiling things down into like the grid that I used is a great example. So rather than showing raw locations, you can aggregate them to some spatial reference that will allow you to use the maximum amount of data, right? So I think that still can be very useful. I mean, especially as the wind farms grow out, I mean, now with we have the ones that are built are relatively small, but as the footprint grows and grows, I think your frame of reference spatially can get bigger and bigger and bigger. So yeah, there's ways around it. Aggregation has been my tool.
Travis, thanks. If you have any thoughts.
Yeah, so I'll jump in, and I feel like having like a regional design. So really, like, right now we have, you know, it's difficult having each of the developers doing their own, you know, fisheries monitoring plans with, you know, minimal guidance or guidelines. So I know we're looking, you know, doing 3 years before, 3 years after, coming from a scientific background. That's really, you know, I feel like needed to really understand the impacts of what's happening with these wind farms. So having, you know, a regional approach and maybe having the same, you know, institution conducting these as well. So like we use University of Massachusetts School for Marine Science and Technology. But yeah, and again, it might be different from the Southern New England down to the Mid-Atlantic. You know, there are different developers, but I think that regional approach is really key.
Julia, if I may, I have a question. I'd like to direct this to Jeff Willis, Scott, and Abby specifically. Is the tool, we talked about the possibility of expanding the tool. Do you feel that it could be expanded offshore, number one? And number two, can we use it certainly as a baseline, but can we use it to see what the changing condition is? In other words, would we repeat or add to it every year? I was wondering if someone could address that to see if this tool has that capability.
I'll just go first very quickly and say I would hope so. And whatever it takes to work out the mechanics to make this work in an offshore environment, CRMC would be extremely interested in. I don't think our days of looking at offshore renewable energy projects are over. So the more understanding we have out there of the recreational value and therefore the recreational impact is extremely important. So I would definitely support anything that would get us there.
Apologies if I missed this, but how long did it take to do that data collection? I'm just curious, you know, how long it would take to do this in the offshore environment.
It was it was an 18-month project.
Just looking to the chat, I think a few of the questions have already been answered, but one from Toby Curtis, I think this is for Jeff Kneebone. Given the prevalence of drifting and trolling by HMS anglers, do you feel that targeting HMS within wind areas will be feasible after construction? And then also, could HMS fishing be more impacted than fishing for council-managed species?
Great. Yes. Thanks for the question, Toby. I'll preface this answer by saying that I do a lot of fishing offshore. I have for over 20 years. So going to come at this from a fisherman's perspective, as well as someone who does fishing for research. I actually think there is potential for it, especially with tuna fishing. So in our region, when the tuna bite is on, like this summer, I fished in a fleet of 200 boats that were spread out over maybe 6 or less square miles. So when you add a fixed structure every mile in the middle of that fleet, and you have moving vessels, trolling, casting, drifting, it's chaotic enough when there's no fixed structures in there. It's going to be different when there are. So I think depending on the tactics, it may vary. Drifting is going to be tough. As a shark fisherman, you know, you don't drift in a straight line all the time, and you may drift into a turbine and have to move your vessel and break your chum slick because you run into a turbine. So I actually do think that there's the potential for some disruptions from the physical presence of the turbine, especially when there's large fleets of boats targeting fish in a small area.
Awesome. Julia, I know that we had one other question in the chat that's really easy to answer, and we can have others jump in. Fishing in wind farm areas. I think the question was, can you fish in a wind farm area? What are the restrictions? And there are really no restrictions. You can fish up to the turbines. You certainly can't tie up to a pylon, except when there's construction certainly going on or when there's maintenance. There are safety buffer zones that are employed then. And I do know, Julia, that I think, Scott, you were going to respond to a question. I saw your button come on and off. Do you care to respond to that last question about the survey?
Gotcha. I was just going to add that the Saltwater Anglers Association is still here. We still have the same show that we host every year. So the means of obtaining further data for future efforts is still certainly there. And I think we could just refocus, let people know that we're still taking input for it. And again, we should be doing this both, you know, pre and post. That way we have both sets of data to look at.
Great. I hope we're able to get a lot of responses on that front. You know, it's not just offshore wind planned either. There's sand mining and potential offshore aquaculture. So having that data set available would be immensely helpful.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Whenever you're looking at multiple users of the same area, you know, it's just a fantastic thing to have.
All right. Any other thoughts from the rapporteurs or any of the other panelists? Otherwise, I think we're coming up on our time.
I just had one question of, you know, about the Gulf of Mexico, and, you know, there's obviously experience there with recreational fishing and the oil and gas platforms. Do any of you look to that experience to understand what may or may not happen here, or is it not relevant?
Jen, can I answer that? Because I fish in the Gulf on a regular basis now that I'm semi. Sure. Now we go right up to a rig. Again, you can't, like Dave said, you can't tie up to the rig, but we go right up to the rig, and the productivity in and around the legs of the rig are a lot higher than further away. Now, a rig has a lot more structure in the water than a monopile does, but based on my experience, I believe that you know, we're going to experience similar results around the wind farms like we do along the oil rigs. Again, not as productive, because the oil rigs have a lot more supporting structure going down into the water. But I expect it to be the same. At least my experience is around the Block Island farm. When I fished the Block Island farms, and I fished similar to the way I fish in the Gulf. So
great. Thank you, Tony. All right. Thank you, everyone here on the screen. I really appreciate it. Now we're going to go to the last activity, and I'm going to pass it over to Abby Green from our team to explain.
Hi, everyone. For our last activity, we're going to be doing some breakout rooms. We just, now that we've heard from all these presenters, we really want to make sure that we capture everybody's ideas and input. So we've pasted the link a few times in the chat, and I'm going to do it one more time just to really send it home. This link, which I'm posting right now, is the document that you can use to look at the questions that you should be discussing in these breakout rooms. What information is lacking that's needed for understanding recreational fishing behavior change? You can look at the list of the questions that we've been posting it this whole time, and make sure you discuss that and really listen to each other and discuss it in your breakout room. As people might be aware in Zoom, everything in the chat when you go into a breakout room kind of refreshes. So make sure you have that document open before you click into the breakout room. If you have any difficulty, please just let me know. I'll still be in the main room, so will Jen, and so will Robbie on our team. If you join a breakout room and you don't have a facilitator, just discuss amongst yourselves. I think I've distributed it correctly, so people absolutely should have a facilitator in the room, but things happen. So just have the conversation amongst yourselves and really just let us know what your ideas and input are on that document. We really want to hear from everybody. And we'll only have about 10 minutes, and then we'll join back in the main room together. So I'm going to open up the room, and happy chatting.
Well, all right. Well, we have 41 of us back at least. So I guess we're running low, but are there any last minute comments that people maybe that took a very different direction from what we've been chatting about today that people wanted to share?
I will say that we weren't in a breakout room, but we had a great conversation with Greg, who was talking about he owns a tackle shop, and his feeling is that we're not, there's a lot of, let's say, low-hanging fruit opportunities to engage anglers, and researchers are not taking advantage of that. Is that right, Greg? Did I kind of get that?
For the most part, I mean, it'd be like a 10-minute conversation, but that's for the most part where I'm at. I get sometimes hundreds of customers in the door every day. They're going fishing. And I just feel that there's some really easy, you know, touch points with anglers that are going or just came back, you know, weighing a fish or getting gear for the next day that, you know, there could be like a QR code to scan at say, you know, most tackle shops that you can kind of capture easy data or having, you know, say manpower there to do personal interviews or something like that. Just a thought.
Greg, which tackle shop are you?
I'm in Fisherman's headquarters in New Jersey.
Fisherman headquarters in New Jersey. Okay.
Yeah. And I'm also on New Jersey Marine Fisheries Council on the Offshore Wind Advisory Board. So I've been kind of involved in this process for some time now. Attend a lot of the offshore wind meetings.
Okay. I'll be at the Atlantic City Boat Show in the NYSERDA booth distributing information about offshore wind. If we could get together and talk a little bit more, I'd appreciate it.
Yeah, I won't be there, but I will be at the Saltwater Fishing Expo, where it was mid-March. We got a 50-foot booth there.
You mean the one in New Jersey?
Saltwater Expo, yeah, in Edison, yep.
I'll be at the Rhode Island show instead this time.
Okay.
All right.
Greg, you got to come to Rhode Island. We're all going to be at the Rhode Island show. It's the best one.
That's right.
It's sort of out of my territory, so I'm stepping on other retailers' toes. So okay. I kind of stay in my home turf here.
Is my audio on?
There he is, Jim.
Yeah.
So one of the things, I got invited to a room. I've never been in a breakout room off of Zoom, so I appreciated that. But I was with Andy and Toby. And the one thing that I would mention, and Jennifer, you gave a good lead in here. I appreciate what the New England folks have done. And we talk about the Northeast, but let's consider the fact that New Jersey is part of the Mid-Atlantic region. And we've never seen an in-person discussion like this, a granular discussion about science, recreational fishing, and industrial offshore wind in New Jersey. So while it sounds funny, the New Jersey... The Saltwater Fishing Expo, the Atlantic City Boat Show, these are big events. And we just have not had this type of discussion in New Jersey. And if I look back on some of the slides that were shown before, if you look at the HMS permits, New Jersey leads the way. And I do believe that New Jersey has more registered anglers, perhaps, than many of the other states in the region. And I would just say that the opening of this presentation recognized that there was very little info regarding recreational fishing impacts with industrial offshore wind. So if we want to be serious about this, I think that you should branch out and somebody should come down to Jersey where people are pretty brutally honest with what they're thinking and what they're feeling.
Yeah.
And I told Andy and Toby that I'd be happy to help facilitate a discussion like that.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's great. How about Walt? Walter?
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Todd. Sorry, I got a hard break in like 30 seconds. But the only thing, I mean, we were sort of the one of the academic groups. And really the only thing that we focused on, and the thing that I do want to stress to the group is how, you know, however this goes, whatever data we have, and this was part of the question I asked to Jeff, is really concentrating and thinking about standardization and consistency of any regional scientific and monitoring programs. I mean, the objective here is to understand impacts. And the only way that you're going to be able to do that is if in the end, the data that you collect and or use can be quantified, right? I mean, that's how you're going to know your impacts. It's not going to be, well, I used to fish there and now I don't, or something like that. It really needs to be quantified. And on top of that, it needs to be not only quantified in this area or that area, but really what we want to do is we want to do that across those regions. So it's not just what's happening off of the like what Vineyard Wind is doing, but it's all those floating turbines that might be occurring in the Gulf of Maine, or as was just mentioned, what's going to happen off New Jersey, or even as Jeff alluded to as well, Gulf of Mexico and Caribbean. It's coming to those regions too. So that was the one thing that I just wanted to stress. I don't know if that's working groups. Jen, maybe this is another offshoot of that, but and some of this is already rolling. But I've already looked to Jeff as a guidepost for this, because I at least wanted to say, okay, if I'm going to just launch a project with Matt Davis, I want to at least be able to compare what I'm doing with at least what Jeff is doing in his rate. And with that, I'll lower my hand. Thank you for the time. I'm sorry, I do have to run.
Dave, how about, do you have some thoughts?
Yes, thanks, Todd. The group that I was in the breakout session, there was a lot of excitement about trying to measure in the wind farm recreational fishing activity, a lot of good comments about the study that Scott, Abby, and Jeff presented. But there was a little concern. Well, there was a comment that we should really take advantage of the for hire information in that area because it is readily available because, you know, for hire boats in the area have, it's been mandatory by the state of Rhode Island and then by the Mid-Atlantic region, I think for 4 or 5 years now. So there is that data available. But there was some concern about the volume of recreational fishing. And I know a lot of members of the Rhode Island saltwater anglers fish in wind farm areas now, but we got to try to sort of get at that. The numbers of them aren't like the numbers of folks that fish inshore. So you're not going to have maps like we did of Narragansett Bay with a lot of anglers fishing in different areas. They're going to be a lot fewer anglers because, as we know, NOAA says that 10% of all the fishing trips take place within the 3 mile limit. So that leaves us 10% more, and they're fishing between 3 miles and 200 miles. So there was some concern at getting at that. And at the same breath, folks said, what would be helpful is the for hire data because they're always fishing in that area. I just wanted to share that group discussion comment.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. Before we lose anybody else, I'm just gonna plug that we're gonna have an in-person event to follow this up, and then a webinar. So the in-person event will be in the later on this spring. So let us know, myself or Jen, if you're interested in attending the in-person event to further along this effort. And then Tiffany, Jeff.
I'll be brief. I know we need to end. I just wanted to plug that, you know, big picture, a lot of these conversations have been about building baseline data sets, and that's really important. But if we are only relying on that to measure change over time in fishing behavior, we've got some challenges, right? It's going to take a long time, and there may be questions that won't be answered by simply having geospatial data sets that we can compare over time. And so I just want to encourage and thinking about some other social science dimensions of this. I mean, we know in research that fishers will report, you know, that they didn't enjoy the experience of fishing near a wind farm, and it's associated, David Bidwell and my research showed this, that it's associated with, it's related to values like the association of the idea of progress and green energy. Sorry, the words are not coming, it's been a long day. But that's the, so I think that we're missing something if we don't also look at some of those questions, because fishery behavior around wind farms may be affected, shaped by things that won't be shown in those data, that may be more about value and identity and so on.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I am going to basically close it down. We're a little bit past 7:30, and I understand. Thank everybody for their time and participating and making this, I think, a very successful webinar, and very, makes me want to go recreational fishing tomorrow.
Right now.
But so thank you all, and hopefully you'll be able to participate in the future as we progress and as some of this research matures.
Good night.
Thanks. Thank you everyone for all your effort in putting this together as well. So
thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.
Take care, everyone.
Donnie DeLand. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.